Going to get that going and start playing and letting folks in. We ready, ladies?
All right. Yes, let's go.
All right.
Game on.
She's just a girl and she's on fire. Hotter than a fantasy. Lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire. Filled with catastrophe. But she knows she can fly away.
Like a dance party book.
This girl is on fire. This girl is on fire. She's walking on fire. This girl is on fire.
Well, hello, everyone. It is Friday Eve. Thank you all for attending this fabulous webinar. To all the women and all the girls who are on this call right now, you are on fire on a Thursday. We appreciate you all being here. I am Jody McGarity Jr. I'm coming to you from Round Rock, Texas, which is 20 minutes north of Austin. And we have a great treat for you all. At this time, I am going to go ahead and turn this over to our phenomenal moderator, the lovely Kim Turner.
Oh, thank you, Jody. Hello, everyone. No matter where you are, whatever time zone you're coming in from, we're so glad you're here for our PCA webinar, Recruiting and Retaining Girls into Your Sports Team and or Program. And we're excited to have a really fun, engaging, practical conversation about how to get girls in the game. We are excited to introduce our co-panelists, and I'll share a bit about myself after that. So I am the Gender Equity Initiative Director at PCA, and I'll turn it over to Kendra Carr to introduce herself, and then Carolyn Sadeko. Thanks, Kendra.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation to be here. And hello, everyone. Friday Eve. I'm going to call Friday Eve from now on. Thank you. Thank you, Jody, for that. But I'm Kendra Carr. I'm the Senior Director of Research in the Sports Lab with Girls Leadership. Girls Leadership is a national organization, and we teach girls to exercise the power of their voice. I played sports in elementary and middle school and high school. Basketball became my lifeline. I was also an administrator at an all-girls school and partnered with our athletic director to build out the sports program there. And I'm also a mom of ballers, y'all. I have three sons who are ballers.
Thank you, Kendra. Wonderful. We can't wait to hear more. I'll pass it to Carolyn now. Thank you.
Thanks, Kendra. Well, I too am a mother of ballers. I have two sons. Hi, everyone. I'm Carolyn Sadeko, certified athletic administrator. I'm the founder of Coaching Kahwa Sports Consultants, where we provide sports is life coaching services. So I offer human-centered, holistic, wellness-based sports is life coaching services to people and groups in athletic ecosystems. So glad to be here with y'all.
Thank you, Carolyn. Wonderful. I'm lucky to call Kendra and Carolyn good friends and colleagues for many years. So thank you for joining us. As mentioned, Kim Turner, I'm not only the Gender Equity Initiative Director, but I'm also a Title IX attorney and have been working on getting girls into the game for many years now. I also wear a lot of hats because I am a youth sports coach to girls and all kids. I am a parent of two young children who are mini ballers. And I am just a fan of sports. I did play as well. And I will round this out, even though I love basketball. I'm not as talented in the basketball realm, but I did love volleyball, especially in soccer and softball. And I was bad at tennis, but enjoyed that too. So I know we have a lot of sports fans and parents, guardians, coaches, youth sports leaders from across the country on this call. So whatever hat you wear today, we're excited to offer you basically tips and insights on what can help get and keep girls in the game. I'll also just mention, and we're going to put some resources in the chat today. We're really excited to have a dynamic webinar, which is being recorded, so you can share it with your friends, your family, your colleagues after this. But we're going to share in the chat a bunch of resources as we go along, because it's not just what Kendra and Carolyn are going to share with us today. It's also the PDFs, the websites, the activations that we want you to have at your fingertips so that you can know how to build those girls' programs that last for a long time. Also want to celebrate Title IX's 51st anniversary, which is tomorrow. And so part of the reason we wanted to have this webinar this week is because we're all celebrating this incredible federal civil rights law, which opened doors for really millions of girls and women to play sports and did a lot more to level the playing field in education, publicly and federally funded education for girls, women, and students generally. Also, we are debuting today for the first time ever, so hold on to your hats, our How to Recruit and Retain Girls into Sports Teams and Programs resource. So we'll be putting that in the chat as well. It is a really fun PDF that you can share with, again, your staff, colleague, friends, family, kids on how to get girls in the game. A lot of it's going to be intuitive. You're going to see these tips in this PDF and think, yeah, I know that. But it's going to be something that you can share at a staff meeting or at a planning session or with your own team or your coach's meeting so that they can think about how to get girls in the game. So I'm going to share a couple more background stats right now to situate us on what we're talking about today. And then we're going to turn it over to our experts, Kendra and Carolyn, on what they do to recruit and retain girls in program. So a couple stats to situate us. People say, yes, we've come so far in terms of girls' sports participation. Indeed, we have. So on this eve of Title IX's anniversary, we know that when the law was passed, Title IX, 51 years ago, less than 300,000 girls were playing high school sports in the United States. Yet the law said, we're opening these doors for girls and women. And now today, basically a half century later, we have over 3 million girls playing high school sports in our country. So wow, huge, huge progress. Yet there's more to do because we have over 4 million boys playing high school sports in the country. So almost a million kid gap between girls and boys. And we know that there are many, say, high school and K-12 girls that do want to get in the game and aren't yet in the game. So how do we close that gap is part of what we're talking today about. And then we also like to focus not just on schools and districts sports programs, but community youth sport programs, park and recreation departments, the amazing youth sports organizations across the country. So there's many wonderful people that are getting program out to kids. How do they engage girls in those teams and programs? And I'll also just mention, we really want to focus on getting girls and women of color off the sidelines who have too often not been in the game. And we want to make sure that we're focused on those who have been marginalized and not able to play to create a positive, equitable, and accessible youth sports experience, which is PCA's mission and many of our missions. Also, just want to share with you today, you know, part of the reason we wanted to talk about this is because I travel around the country and talk with youth sport leaders, coaches, schools, districts, parks, and rec. And many folks will say, I want to start a girls basketball program. I want to do girls volleyball, or we had girls tennis 5 years ago, but we can't get girls to try out or come back. So I just decided, let's have a conversation about what really works, because who has a lot of time and extra resources? None of us. Right? We don't have a ton of resources. So how can we be creative with the time and staff and resources we have to get girls in the game? So thanks again to Jody for putting in the chat some resources as we go, including our new Recruit and Retain Girls resource. And please do note that we can ask questions as we go along in the chat. Jody's going to help us with monitoring the chat, and we'll take those at the end of today's dialogue. And if we don't get to your question today, we're happy to email you or connect with you through our genderequity@positivecoach.org email address. All right, so now, without further ado, I want to kick it off to start discussing what are some of those keys to recruit girls into programs. And picture for yourself, your school, your district, your youth sports program, your park and rec, and maybe you have just, you know, 5, 10, 15% girls in programs. Some teams have none. So how can you start that ball rolling? We like our sports puns here. To get more girls in the game. So right now I am going to turn the first question over to Kendra. So if you can kick us off, we're curious, Kendra, can you share a little bit about the groundbreaking girls leadership, middle school basketball, girls programming that you've been doing, this project recently, and what's working to recruit girls onto those middle school girls basketball teams that girls leadership is piloting? What's working for you day to day in that amazing project? And we'll put in the chat some details about that as well.
Awesome. Yes. Thanks for this question. So Girls Leadership partnered with Her Time to Play, which is, if you haven't heard of it, it's an initiative of the Junior MBA program supported by the WNBA and NBA. And the purpose was to explore girls' participation in sports, especially girls of color. And then the goal of that was to create resources for girls' basketball coaches to then go and use to prioritize joy and wellness and connection among the teams. And so Girls Leadership's model is to do it through the sports lab. And so we deeply listen to girls by like building relationships and holding conversations with them about their lives and experiences. Because of Girls Leadership, we believe girls are the experts of their own lives and experiences. So this year I had two middle school basketball after school programs, and I worked with an AAU team with eighth and ninth grade girls, and we ran the lab at their practice once a week. But as I learned from the girls, I share out what worked. So when you visit our website, you can get more information on how to access the activities we created for girls coaches and some of the trainings. But some of the successes of the programs were like girls improved their mental health. You know, we're in the midst of a mental health crisis for girls. The CDC put out a recent report. Girls felt more confident. There were girls who weren't participating in PE. I got there a little early to set up and saw girls in my program sitting out of PE, y'all, not participating. The PE teacher wasn't even asking them to engage, but then they came to the program right after school and played. But before any of those successes, right, your question is like, we had to get them to the gym first. And so what worked? One was that I made myself really visible on campus, y'all. So my piece of advice is go where the girls are. Like flyers and announcements are great, like secondary tools, but we can't expect them to come to us. We have to go where they are. So at lunchtime, I was walking around, had an interactive table with like, you know, a ball, you know, a basketball. And I use a lot of phrases because one of the things we learned too is that girls want to have fun, right? So I'm like, we're going to have fun. You're going to be with friends, make new friends. You know, you have to do it in your own style and your energy, but basically letting them know that this is fun. And so that was really important to go where they are. The other thing that I found is that representation really matters. So on the flyers, I have brown and dark skinned girls and different body sizes. I think girls are more likely to come to programs when they see themselves on the materials, when they see themselves represented. And I just want to say one note about that, because I also want to say, be careful not to just put the images, you know, without kind of knowing the issue. So like if you're putting different body sizes, know about body image issues that girls face. If you don't necessarily work with girls of color, make sure you take the time to like develop a culturally responsive mindset. Like, so the images are important is what I'm saying, but also the work paired with it to make sure girls are served well. I also want to say, y'all, girls were hungry, so I brought food. It was right after school, and some girls don't eat all day. And so I had food every time. So we ate a meal at the beginning of every session. I mean, you'd be surprised too, the water table, they ran to get water. So food and water were really important. I also really leveraged the partnership with Her Time to Play. So the girls, they seem really excited that the WNBA was sponsoring this program. There were some like free giveaways. And I just think the last thing about this particular program was that I joined a local alliance. PCA was hosting it. So where I'm in the Bay Area of California. So the Oakland Sports Equity and Access Coalition. So I just want to say, it's really important not to do the work alone too in this. We have to connect. And so I was able through that coalition to really ask my peers what they were doing. And what worked.
Thank you, Kendra.
Time for one more thing.
Oh, please. Yes.
Okay. You know, my time check just, okay. I just wanted to share something from an administrator's perspective too, working at the high school. There's a ton on our plates as administrators, but we really have to make time to meet and plan with our athletic directors, like the coaches, the athletic staff. You know, my AD asked for more time to plan and vision with me, and I had to make, she was really persistent, y'all. And we met, and one of the successes of us meeting was that we figured out that the purpose of our sports programming was deeply connected to our mission to support girls, not just as athletes, but their full development, their full humanity. And so knowing our why really increased, like it widened our perspective of what it meant to have a successful program. So I just want to say making time as an admin. So I'm wearing those two hats today. Making time as an admin is really critical.
Yes, thank you, Kendra. Just to review a couple of amazing nuggets you've shared, things like visibility in the recruiting, things like making it fun and dynamic, having those sports balls to play with, having snacks, having food available so that girls can get energized, physically, emotionally for that sport, thinking about their day and what they've experienced before they get to you, that they haven't maybe been as physically active as they want to be or as focused upon as you're then bringing to the table, which is great. And things like the administrator hat. I know I'm seeing folks are calling in from all across the country for this webinar. Thank you in the chat for sharing your different cities and states. And I imagine that folks, no matter what hat you're wearing, making that time to talk about girls recruitment for sports teams, making that time in your athletic director, your coaches meeting, your staff meeting, whatever sports organization you're running or you're part of or you're coaching with, making that time. So thank you for those nuggets and many others that you shared. All right, so we'll continue talking a little bit about recruiting, and then we're gonna turn to retaining girls in sports teams and programs. And feel free to keep adding Kendra in the chat or later in the conversation. So question for Carolyn, as a longtime women athletic director, and we know there's very few women athletic directors in the country, and there are thankfully more each day, but we want more and more to be out there, and Carolyn's lived that experience. She's worked for decades on recruiting girls to sports teams. So what have you seen, Carolyn, working day to day in terms of recruiting girls to sports teams and programs? And this could be in a school environment, in a park and rec environment, mixed teams or all girls teams. What have you seen work on recruiting?
Hi, thanks, Kim. Oh, Kendra, I'm already writing down a lot of notes from your perspective too. And we, just like you said, we do this in community. Right? We do this work in community, and that community is very diverse, right? In all intersections of existence. So when I think about sports programs, I really think like with any other youth development programs, and that's how we're looking at. We're looking at sports as a youth development pathway. So I want to be very clear with that. But these all grow out of our foundational sense of belonging and attachment. Right, as a general course of human growth, right? So meeting needs, if you will. So as program directors and coaches, what may have worked for our own sense of belonging, I'm a little older than Title IX, just a wee bit older than Title IX. But what might resonate with my own experience with how I was socialized into sports might not resonate as clearly now. And so I have to be very conscious about what I'm transmitting as an administrator, as a practitioner. What am I transmitting that is relevant to the needs now? So if you are a practitioner that's experiencing a lot of dissonance, like these kids don't get it, or this wasn't like the sports that I grew up with, and we love to play, and why do I have to, I'm hitting my head against the wall with trying to get participants. And I'm going to present this, right? A few weeks ago, PCA's last webinar, Dr. Julie McCleary from Washington stated that sports is a masculinized space. And we need to expand and demasculinize our mindsets and assumptions in order to develop inclusive sports programming. So here's some examples. Language. Right? There are so many options to the word guys that are inclusive, and we need to practice that. So people, teammates, friends, players, have your participants also contribute to that. Of course, we want to keep it clean, keep it, respectful, right? And that's where you and your expertise is needed, right? But also that openness to learn how we can, in our expansive language, kind of interrupt those systems that really need to be questioned these days, right? Because it's not working right now with our own programming. So we have to kind of deprogram ourselves a little bit. Another tip is sponsorship. So if you are in a program that seeks sponsors, whether that's community sponsors or programs that you collaborate with, look specifically for women-owned or operated small businesses to sponsor your organization. So my one quick story about that is at the height of the pandemic, one of the participants on our girls team started making videos on how to do decorative nails. And through the pandemic, she developed this entrepreneurial mindset, and she opened a small business where she would do decorative nails for her friends and family and teammates. And she was a varsity basketball player. She integrated that into the sports programming, and the coaches loved that. So that was like an incentive to keep girls on teams. You know, they got to get their nails done by her and things like that. That's very simple, but asking about who has the resource that are right in front of you, right? A last tip here is that those team members, and Kendra was alluding to this, right? Like not just having their images on flyers and promotional materials, but they themselves, whether they be girl identified, gender expansive identified, that they are the primary creators of whatever public facing content you have. So let them do the work. They love it, you know, and invite them to it. Support them with women that are in sports contexts, that are media creators, that are in other aspects of sport related professions that can support them in that. If that is not your expertise, there's someone there who would love to do that probably. So male identified coaches and siblings, family members should not only witness this happening, they should also be promoting it and kind of co-signing onto that. So that's actual ally behavior that we want to see. We want to see brothers, fathers, we want to see male identified folks in that sports context take direction from women and girls. Be the one to ask the questions. Be the one that says, I will follow your direction. You know, absolutely. And that modeling has to happen.
Yeah, thank you for that, Carolyn. And you're alluding to some great points we'll get into later on allyship. So thank you for that. And I love those points about taking an interest in your girl participants, interests of their own that they bring to the table. And just, I can't help but plug in a fun fact on that sports business connection. Mm-hmm. And that sports economic connection that studies show, one economist actually studied this and showed that girls who play high school sports go on to make 7% higher wages than their non-athlete peers. So we know that it's not just fun and games for girls to play sports. It's actually dollars and cents, because we know that they get business lessons like resilience, like leadership, like teamwork that they take into an economic context later in life. So thank you for highlighting that, and so much about language and how we address one another in respectful ways beyond, hey guys, you know, that's a basic one that I think a lot of us are still working on. Like, how can we make sure to address a mixed group of kids in a respectful way where they all feel included? So thank you for those many examples. All right, so we're now going to turn to a question to both of you on our new resource. So in our development zone, PCA's website, where there's tons of great resources on lots of topics, including getting girls in the game, our resource is talking about how you can basically get more girls in the game and keep them on teams over time. And so I wanted to ask Kendra and Carolyn, based on this new resource that I think Jody put in the chat already, but we can reinsert in the chat as well, what are some of your favorite tips from this fact sheet that you see working? Because sometimes it's like, great, someone told me this is the tip, this is the key, but you're like, does it work in real life? Maybe you can share a quick story on one of these tips from our resource and how it worked in real life to get girls to the court, to the gym, to the pool, wherever they are. So go ahead, Kendra and Carolyn, with your favorite tip from our resource.
Yeah, I feel like I'm like cheating a little bit because it's the first one. The first one is my favorite, which is plan early and often. And I shared the story of the athletic directors that I partnered with at when I was a principal. And really, it was so necessary because one, as a school, we did not have facilities on campus. So we were a small school. We had a practice gym. You can't play there. We had swimming, track, softball, golf. We had a lot of sports. And so we needed facilities. So that planning early, it really meant we had to sit down and have a multi-year vision. And we're always looking a year ahead. And so definitely in terms of facilities. Also, when I was talking about the why earlier, like we needed time to find coaches whose coaching philosophies aligned with our mission. Like we wanted to bring in coaches who also agreed that it was important, that we're looking at it through a youth development lens. I appreciate that language, Carolyn. And so we needed time to find those coaches. And then also like budget wise, you know, I think we all share in this that more resources are needed. And so it also gave us some time to think about creative ways of fundraising, you know, by planning early and looking ahead. We have to get really creative asking folks to sponsor us. Plan early and often was the first tip that I would highlight.
Thank you, Kendra. That's amazing. I appreciate that. I'm sure with your Her Time to Play Girls Basketball Initiative, knowing ahead of time, you know, when you were going to have gym time, what, you know, how many girls might be interested, making sure you had enough snacks, you know, which I know being a parent to two children who love their snacks, you know, just making sure that you have those things at the ready is key, and planning, you know, weeks, months, sometimes years in advance, obviously for programs that are thinking ahead, like a Park and Rec is thinking, oh, if we want to launch volleyball in a year's time, how do we start that? So let's plan early and often. Thanks for that. How about you, Carolyn, in terms of some of your favorite tips?
Oh, so many favorites, but I did select one, and that is number four, train and support coaches to best coach girls. This is on a bit more of a broader sort of sense, and really of again, this systematic reflection on how sports is transmitted to us, right? So like I stated earlier, like those of us who loved our formative experiences in sports need to invite youth and their family members, right? Like, so now like that whole community vision has to be operationalized, right? Because those members, those families, especially the families who relate to being historically marginalized and erased, right, by our competitive and elitist narrative in sports, like who were cut from their teams maybe as a teen, or who were thought that it wasn't for them, right? Those are the people that we need to reach out to. And those are the people who are, but then who's coaching? Who's coaching girls now? Who's coaching athletes now? Are the people who succeeded in that paradigm that no longer serves us if we want to retain and recruit girls? So your vision cannot only just be to replicate your own experience, right? You need input from other people. You need input for how sports has benefited them, and then working with them. So we have to model how sports programs are evolving away from the dehumanizing competition and oppressive power systems to this broader, more inclusive, some people characterize it as family, as community. And that we got to reclaim that in the sense of power, right? In the sense of this is what will generate resources. This is where the resources lie, is in the community. So training coaches to understand that sort of, it's a mind shift. It's a mind shift in our framework of how we understand how sports benefits us. We exist to benefit from sports, and sports doesn't exist. We don't benefit to the service of sports. Sports is there for us. So centering people in that is the thing that I want to really, that's my work. That's my work, is in retaining and training adults in this context. To really be of service.
Yes, thank you for that, Carolyn. And, you know, I imagine seeing again all the folks on the chat and where they're from wearing these different hats. Often folks that are coaching sports are those that were successful in them, mm-hmm. and kind of became naturally. You loved your soccer, basketball, volleyball, football, whatever it was, and you want to share that love and that experience with kids. But some kids don't have that, you know, natural ability or that encouragement from home. And I'll just quickly share, to your point, Carolyn, what you're sharing makes me think a lot about what I've learned over the years with, say, all girls sports teams. Whereas I grew up with a brother, 6'8", and I played with my mom, my dad, my brother. We were effectively a mixed sports team growing up. And I enjoyed playing with boys and, you know, that challenge. That being said, I know a lot of girls over the years that I've coached, especially, say, at Title I after school programs, a soccer program that I used to coach. where girls had never played soccer in their lives and felt pretty intimidated kicking that ball around. Sometimes it was the first time they'd ever had a chance to kick a ball. And so having an all-girls environment, a lot of the studies are showing girls, many girls really want that environment, even from a very young age, you know. And yet we still want to make space for mixed and boys and girls and kids of any gender orientation and expression, but how we have to acknowledge that what worked for us may not be what the kids we're coaching need. And so back to Kendra's point too, is like learning what the girls want, you know, centering their experience. I think we've talked about that a few times today. It's like, ask, I mean, one of the simplest things, ask the girls what they need and want, ask the kids what they want is a key for recruiting and retaining girls in programming. So thank you for that, Carolyn. All right, so we're going to keep flying with our agenda here. There's so many good things. We're now going to shift a little bit over to retaining girls in sport, because what I've heard, and I think Kendra and Carolyn have seen and heard, is you might have a really successful softball or basketball or soccer program for girls for, say, a couple of years, and then you lose that great coach, or funding becomes tight, or maybe a star captain girl on the team graduates, and she was a lot of the momentum on the team. She was doing that recruiting on campus or in the park and rec, or her family was really instrumental in keeping the girls connected. So what do we do to retain girls on teams when we sometimes see them separating from sport, particularly in middle school years? We see that change in girls' participation. So what do you see, Kendra, turning to you first, in terms of girls' sports teams and programs that launch with initial success, and then they might struggle after one season or several seasons? What do you see keeping girls coming back to the program year after year, season after season?
Yeah. I appreciate this question because I really empathize with it. And there are kind of like two different contexts that I want to just share some words about. And the first is around for those who are running clinics or camps or other sports programmings where, you know, girls come initially, but then they don't return. So it is really important to understand the experience that they had. So asking them, I know we said that a lot, but I think hopefully that's what everyone walks away with, like really asking them. But one of the things that, a couple of things I've heard from girls who have played in mixed gender settings and then don't come back, you know, I think we have to make sure that coaches are paying attention to the girls in those programs. So there was a boxing program that I observed. There are about 30 boxers. There were two girls. The rest were boys. And the girls literally at one point stopped participating. They were in a corner. I saw the coach glance, but didn't say anything. And maybe the coach didn't know how to engage them. Maybe he needed some training or support around that, but just making sure that the coaches give girls equal attention in those mixed gender settings, not ignore them.
Absolutely.
Also like making sure girls have a role. So making sure they swing the bat, touch the ball, have an opportunity to be a part of the action. I heard from this group of girls that the boys wouldn't pass the ball to a basketball group of girls. The boys wouldn't pass the ball. And every time they did get the ball, the boys would play extra hard defense, right? They would go and block their shots, steal it from them. And it was fun and funny to the boys, but the girls didn't want to be a joke, right? So, so just recognizing like where girl in mixed gender settings, again, where girls can have a role.
Yes.
And then just like, I feel like this is a simple, like low hanging fruit for all girls settings. Just Can we give the girls an opportunity to learn each other's names? And remember, this is like in the camp or clinic setting. Mm-hmm. Instead of like the first thing we do is jump into a drill, let's like play a name game so we can show girls that they matter, that they're all in a community. And so I just want to share that because I've seen that happen a couple of times too, where the girls are like, "Hey, you," and I'm like, "Haven't you been together all day? You don't know her." You know.
Yes, absolutely.
Just because we didn't create the opportunity. But I just also want to say we did some focus groups last year, some national focus groups. And so this is more like high school level teams. One thing that came up about like reasons girls quit, stop playing is because of like team drama or team conflict. There was one high school varsity team that had an incident happen that really split the team. They were all sectioned off and like took sides, right? And they weren't going to have a team, but then at the last minute they chose to, their school counselor came in and did some work with them. But can I tell you, this team won their state championship. So like the fact that they almost didn't have a team, but just thinking about like teams that have some like inner, some dynamics that need to be, where they need to be supported. coaches can like co-create team agreements, like at the beginning of the season, where every girl and coach shares what they need. So you like, on this team, I need, and you hear from everyone on this, and then what they bring to on this team, I offer, and you hear from everyone. And that's something that you can return to throughout the, it's like the foundation. You return to it throughout the season. If something happens, bring everyone together and talk about it. I also think, again, from the youth development framework, that lens, just checking in at the beginning. And so there's a fun, it's an easy one we always use called the self-care battery, where people just share like where their battery level is today. Like before we get into it, like, how are you as a person? It just makes people feel connected and again, seen. Mm-hmm. I love that idea of the varsity player, Carolyn, the varsity mm-hmm. player. And because one of the suggestions that I was going to bring was like figuring out what girls are interested in, like outside mm-hmm. of the sport. Is it music? Is it STEM? Is it activism? And I know many women who are former athletes who are out there doing that work would love to come and just speak about the work they're doing, or could like host the team for like a volunteer session, like in the community. But just thinking of ways to really have the team be family. We're, you know, and not just seeing ourselves as siloed as athletes, but like we're in this together.
Yes. Thank you, Kendra. These are great, great points. I hope people are madly scribbling them down. This will be recorded as well. So if you're not scribbling, you can absolutely watch this recording again. And thank you for those terrific tips. I know Kendra also shared the other day with me, you know, coach listening to the kids' music and taking an interest in the music that they liked and dancing with them, you know, was really effective for connecting with girls in a certain environment. And I think with all kids. So thank you for those wonderful, wonderful examples. And Carolyn, I'm going to turn it over to you for retaining girls in sport. And hopefully we can thread in the question in the chat as well, in terms of what you've seen work to retain girls in sports and your experience as an administrator and coach. And then to the question in the chat, how do you encourage coaches to engage girls that you see starting to withdraw? So you might get a sense in the middle of the season, oh, this girl was really excited about this volleyball or this hockey or this basketball team. And now they're starting to kind of, retreat a little bit and be less engaged at each practice. What you might do about that?
Oh, gosh. Okay. As I answer all questions with like, how do we do this in community? How do we do this collectively? And for those questions really is really asking, right? So I can't carry it all myself, that's kind of counter to what we're taught in our society here, is to, you know, be a leader. And like, you know, I have no problem volunteering people to do stuff, right? But in terms of that, what that means is volunteer asking, right? Asking the girls, can you get this training? If we make time and we incentivize you to do this training on how to keep score, on how to run the gym, on how to turn on lights and manage emergency systems. If we make that available to you, can you please do that? And you could still be part of this broader culture of sports, right? If they don't like playing, or if they somehow are feeling, you know, not belonging, we ask them what will help you. Do you want to be a team manager? You know, do you want to get, and we do this for families too. Those parents that sit in your stands a half an hour before the game starts, because they have to drive their kids to the game, and they're sitting there and you're waiting for them to like blow up in the stands, right? We had a parent, I bless her heart. We had a parent who would do her half hour fitness walking out in the neighborhood right before her daughter's games. And we asked her, can you please take some parents with you? Can you please help them? Can you please just start conversations with them? And then that evolved into a fitness walking group like that would meet like 45 minutes before the game.
Right.
And so those things like that. So a common narrative that I've experienced is that sports is a privilege, right? That it's a function of fun and enhancement only, right? And it seems like that it, in the priorities of life, that it gets deprioritized, right? Yes. And so how do we make it? How do we invite folks to create it, to have it integrate in their priorities as a family, whether that's their own participation, whether that's their kids' participation? And that's how we are retaining it, because when it's an expectation that every member of the family, no matter who they are, is participating and engaging in sports in some way, then that's how we retain them in programs.
Yes. Yes. You know, thank you for that, Carolyn, on, you know, the mom, the parent, the guardian, the caretaker of the kid, and engaging them to keep the girl in the game, because it is that ecosystem around a child that's important, that infrastructure, that scaffolding around them that's so important. And you know, I'll just put it in the chat, or Jody can, but, you know, basically we also did a literature review at Positive Coaching Alliance of 100+ studies with expert researchers to see what gets and keeps girls in the game from a design standpoint, and parental and guardian involvement, particularly moms, was found in the studies to be very instrumental to keeping girls in the game. So I love that you might talk to the girl who's withdrawing from the team and find out what's going on and what might be helpful to adjust. Does she want to run a drill? Does she want to choose a drill and have that voice and choice and ownership in the next practice that might get her more in the game? And then to Jody's point in the chat, uniform quality, things like, you know, making sure that girl who might be retreating from the program feels comfortable in those shorts that she's been given to wear for that high school soccer team. I mean, I've talked with many girls in communities that say, look, these uniforms aren't comfortable. They're not fitting us. There may be hand-me-downs from boys' teams. That can be a real problem. So our literature review was very exciting in that we found some of those keys. And again, recognizing that sports programs don't have endless time and staff and resources to figure out what works for girls, this literature review, which is just 2 pages, distills not the problems, but the breakthroughs, what you can do about it, which I love because it's action-oriented.
Right. So if I could just also say with that, in terms of, like, you know, resource and resource availability, a uniform that a girl can be, if you could promise to a girl that she will have that number, numbers are very important to them, right? If she could have that number for as long as she participates in the program, no one else will have that number, that is hers. And that is her contribution. And then if she's in the program, let's say it's a high school program, or for the length of the program, how long it is, that she gets to keep that uniform. Like, that's her attachment to the program. And that helps to build culture of commitment. And so it's a very simple thing that doesn't cost any money, because you're going to have to get new uniforms anyway, perhaps. But that creates that belonging. So something as simple like that. And then what I like to do is create ceremony and ritual around that to really solidify that they participated, that they existed in this way, in this sporting way with the community. So those are really creative and easy ways that we can integrate that really don't take a lot of money, to be honest.
Great. Yes, agreed. I love that point. All right. Now, I do want to take this time flies by because we have so much fun in these conversations. And I know we want to leave a little time for Q&A. I want to pivot now to allyship and systems change. And I know on this call, we have a lot of men, and we may have boys, and we have folks who might be coaching boys and not coaching girls, or who are athletic directors that are maybe more connected to boys teams, or girl dads. You know, we have folks who may have only boys as kids, you know? So one of the things I'm really passionate about, and we're all passionate about, is allyship around the table. How can anyone and everyone, regardless of their gender, the hat they wear, the kids they coach, be an ally, be a supporter? So I'm going to ask Kendra what we can do to be allies if we're not necessarily directly coaching girls, or a woman coach. You know, what can we do as allies? What would you recommend?
Yeah, I love that. I want to start as a parent, because I'm the parent of 3 sons, and I want my boys to be allies. And so Kim, you and I talk about this often, kind of like every time we get on the call. But you know, it's really important. In my house, we watch women's sports. We watch it just as much as I feel like we watch women's sports more. It's probably because of me, but like women's college sports are on just as much as men's. My sons, we go to my niece is in 2nd grade. Y'all, she plays softball. Yes. Mm-hmm. We go to her games and cheer her on. You know, my boys, you know, our family comes to see them, and I want to make sure they know that we go and support our, you know, support our family members who are girls who play too. My kids, when they play, we stay and cheer for the girls games, right? Like we don't leave, you know? and so I just think I'm just sharing that because it feels easy. It feels simple. Mm-hmm. And then from the perspective of just like taking an experience from this year, like when girls are in the gym, I noticed that when like two male teachers were walking through the gym, like the girls started it kind of got a little tense in there, and they just walked in whenever they wanted. Like, I'm like, we're in here. Can you respect the time? But they just walked through whatever they wanted. And then another male staff member came and played on the sideline hoop. So just also respecting the space and respecting mm-hmm. that girls need space sometimes privately, you know, like without, if that's possible. I know there's a lot of gym sharing and all of that, but like, if you can stay out of the gym when it's the girls' time or off the court, wherever the sports program is, giving girls that, just respecting that space.
Yes, thank you for that. And I'm just noticing, I'm not sure the chat is enabled right now. So if folks want to put their questions into the Q&A function, I think they can lodge questions in the Q&A function. And if you're having any issues with that, let us know. Jody is amazingly helping us with production. But yes, absolutely space. I can't emphasize enough in my years of being a Title IX attorney for our girls in sports, how critical it is to make sure that, you know, you're a girls soccer team and you need that field, and having that boys soccer team clear the field at the time at which your permit begins or your space, your allotment. So, so important for adult sports, for youth sports. I've talked with so many people about facility sharing and just respect. And we'd want that for anyone and everyone, that fairness. Weight room time, for example, football team clears the weight room. Softball gets in at their regularly appointed time. And there's a lot of respect in that exchange. And I think it's also exciting because we're teaching kids how to respect one another in these sports environments around space that translates into homes, into communities, into workplaces of the future. So sports obviously is that character building vehicle that we all enjoy it to be. So Carolyn, do you want to share a couple of quick allyship suggestions for folks, no matter what role or hat they wear?
My recommendations would be to face internally, right? To reflect on your own experience in sports cultures, especially if you are male identified. We like to say people of the global majority need for dominant culture folks to really reflect on their own experience, right? Be curious about the narratives that you haven't been exposed to or socialized into. Think about what in this expansive way, attuned to that. Attuned to not just the experiences of people not like you, but also know that those experiences are also many and vast. So ask, is that way of thinking like helping me and the people that I care about? That very simple reflection. In sports, right? A quick story is I had a parent who would and my story here is about the coach, a male coach who had two adult children. One was a woman identified adult offspring, and he still had a lot of intimacy issues, right, with relationships. And he loved coaching, but he was always coaching in sports, you know, in sports talk, right? And that was his relationship with his daughter. But when he joined our coaching staff, I said, how are we going to negotiate this? Because a lot of those girls don't know that socialized way of talking, and sports wasn't accessible to them. And what he came up with was a journal. And he would share, he had the system for sharing the journal, and he had prompts about sports, about their lives. And it was a way for him to learn about them. And we put a lot of good controls around how this would be operationalized, right? But that was his way of really showing them and modeling respect to them, that he cared about them, but that he also was like this guy who needed help. So availing himself to learning and to being taught by the very people that he wants to coach.
Yeah, thank you for that, Carolyn. You know, just also thinking too about kind of related to that, men who coach boys maybe all their lives and who have connected with me and started coaching girls or co-ed mixed teams and just loved it, didn't realize how rewarding it can be and how fun. And, you know, I just also want to emphasize Positive Coaching Alliance has so many trainings and workshops for people who've never coached, who've coached a long time and need to sort of expand a little bit on getting those new perspectives. So I just want to flag that, you know, we're all at a point where we can grow and do more and expand and get out of our comfort zone to meet the needs of the kids that we may not be currently serving, but could serve. So, wow, perfect timing. We're in our Q&A mode. This is fantastic. And I do want to emphasize, this is an ongoing dialogue. And as Jody's putting in the chat, we've had webinars in the past. There'll be webinars in the future. There's so many resources from our game plan for girls in sports to the new recruiting and retaining girls on your team resource and a ton on the PCA website, as well as from Carolyn and Girls Leadership. So I'd like to open up the first question to our panelists from Maddie Phillips. So what strategies can you use when engaging in discussions with schools who've had limited space to accommodate only one team on their sites, where their preference is to have a co-ed or mixed team, but the objective is to prioritize having an all-girls space or all-girls team? And, you know, I just want to flag, I think we all know space is a restraint in our parks and rec, our schools and districts, and permitting and whatnot is very tight around the country. So what do we do when we have limited space to make some all-girls space or girls-centered space that's fair and hopeful, hopefully great for everybody?
I want to ask Maddie, like, is this like in designing or planning, or like, does the space already exist?
Maybe, Carolyn, if you could stay broad to people who are, you know, dealing with that, you know, tomorrow restraint, to something like where they're planning a year in advance with a limited gym space. And that way we can hopefully give tools to anyone at any point in a facilities conversation.
Right. In my experience, deference has to be made to the girls' teams. So I'll be clear. Like, you're asking the girls' teams when they are able to practice. And then you're prioritizing that. In my experience, boys teams they'll show up for practice whatever time, and so they actually have more flexibility in when they're scheduled for practice. So ask the girls teams first, because that is what we're trying to make equitable. Ask the girls teams first. Ask the women coaches. Ask what their preferences are, and then program that in, and then the guys teams, the boys teams will go around that, and they'll still show up. So and that, I think, is an approach that is that's served well in other areas.
Absolutely. Kendra, do you want to chime in on that?
I love that. And I just prioritize girls, center girls. Girls need these affinity spaces right now. And I'm just thinking of like how we've had to be creative and resourceful all along. And so just having the facilities challenge, you know, at the school I was at, we also looked at like local park, because in the challenge that I had, it was an all girls school, but the challenge that I had is we had multiple teams that were playing in a season, and they all needed space, practice time at the same time. So also looking like at what are the nearby parks. For some reason, Maddie, I'm imagining that it's an elementary school, so I'm sorry if it's not, but like, wouldn't the kids have fun walking to a local park, like getting off campus a little bit, like if it's a soccer team or a, you know, and then I just also was thinking about how can we split the time, can we split the time, and maybe practice is just an hour as opposed to like a 2 hour block. Just so I just want to emphasize, like, creative problem solve. We've got it. We just need, you know, if we just take time to think a little bit, just tap into creativity is what I'm saying. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Thank you for that, Kendra, Carolyn. I love that point about, if we think historically, girls and women in sports have been disadvantaged and have come from behind. And it's only in the last really 50 years or so that we've seen girls' participation, women's participation explode, but it's still, we have further to go and there's still a lot of barriers. So I love that idea of really trying to center girls and women, you know, first, because it has been such a challenge. And then also being creative. So I have seen endlessly with parks and rec and schools across the country where they don't have enough gym space, soccer field space, et cetera. And they use those creative solutions, joint use agreements with parks and rec down the street, or unused space that they didn't realize they could be using. You know, sometimes there is that field that hasn't been activated yet, for example, And just getting around the table with all the folks in your town, city, county to be creative, and also make sure that the girls aren't the one always walking to the park off campus. You know, that's something. So Title IX's anniversary tomorrow, making sure that whatever creative space you're doing usage, you're making sure it's gender equitable so that the boys go off campus 1 week, the girls go off campus the next week. That is so key to getting girls on and coming back to your program, because if they feel that they're a second class in the facility usage, they're not going to come back.
Right. And actually, you know what, Kim, if I could also just build on that real quickly, like this creative piece, right, that takes a lot of mental energy from, and it's usually on people that are trying to like create these programs, and usually falls on people of color, really, to prioritize and make equitable these creative solutions, right? And what I'm going to try to suggest is that you use those creative solutions for the boys teams. That's all. Give the girls the default programming, right, where you prioritize them, and then all your creative solutions are like, oh well, how are the boys going to get to the baseball diamond, you know? Then you'll have a lot of energy poured into that, because boys have historically had the access to that. So just you know, shift that a little bit, right? And that creative effort, really, the default effort of what structures already exist, just give those to girls.
Absolutely. Yeah, so gosh, time is flying. I know that we only have a couple minutes left. I just wanna note, folks are getting great questions into the Q&A feature. I want to emphasize again, genderequity@positivecoach.org is a web address that you can write for ongoing questions and dialogue, and the resources we put in the chat, which, for example, people watching the recording may not see the chat. So I just want to flag, we have our game plan for girls in sports, which is a great resource guide. It's now in pieces, so you can actually look at the individual PDFs for things like recruiting women coaches to your program, which we know women coaches are great role models that get girls playing and staying in the game. Allyship, you know, some of the things about facility equity and access are all in the game plan, as well as our literature review, as well as our new resource. So Jody, I think we have time for one more question. I did see two different things, one about meetings ahead of time and grade level approaches. You know, we're obviously talking about K-12 today. That's a big swath. You know, elementary school girls are going to have different needs than middle school girls, than high school girls. So I want to flag that, you know, there's more to drill down in terms of the needs of each subset. And that's something we could talk about offline. And then I did see in the chat also, what do we do if girls are hesitant to sign up? So maybe we'll leave on that question, because I think that's something I do see a lot. Kendra and Carolyn, could you just quickly address, what do you see working if a girl's thinking about trying that sport, coming out for a trial, but she's not quite sure? What gets her over that concern?
The first thing that's coming to mind for me is just the giving her a chance to try without the pressure of like making a long-term commitment, right? Like saying, let's come out for, I was going to say not an info session, but like, let's just try it, whether it's like open gym or, and I think emphasizing fun. I also think when girls can come with friends, when they're not coming by themselves. So if there's a way you can recruit them, look and pay, recruit in pairs, have them bring a friend along. Yeah, that's what I would say. The other thing about like, sometimes when girls are, in my experience, right, when girls were hesitant or they didn't come out, I felt like there were some times where we as the adults missed the context. And so I just remember this one student who was like the caretaker of a younger sibling. She wanted to play, but she wouldn't come out. And so she was a caretaker of a younger sibling. And so just thinking of like, I know all of our local contexts will be different, but just thinking about resources that are available, maybe it's transportation because the family can't get, you know, a kid to a particular practice or game time. And so is there a way you could do like a shuttle or other parents supporting?
Oh, cool. Yeah, thank you, Kendra, for those great ideas. And definitely the research shows buddy registration works. So if girls can sign up together and know one other girl, that really helps with the confidence. Carolyn, do you want to close us out with our last tip on helping hesitant girls join in? It'd be great.
Incentivize. Yeah. So like they sign up as a family. They sign up as a group, Yeah, in multiples, like they need that support to belong. So whoever it is that they attach to, whether that's an adult or a peer, someone who they can bring along beside them, right, to experience that. So whether it's even someone who's allowed to be in the gym while they are practicing, to offer them that sense of safety and security, make that happen.
Yeah, thank you for that, Carolyn. Wow, we want to be respectful of time. I'm just going to put Women's Sports Foundation information on why girls in sports and women in sports is a good thing if that girl needs also that extra motivation on why it's going to be life-changing to play that sport. So thank you so much. I'm going to pass it back to Jody. We have loved talking with you today. Thank you so much for your time, Kendra, Carolyn, and Jody. Thank you, audience members, for joining us today. Keep the questions rolling to our email address and keep visiting Positive Coach. And thank you so much. Happy Title IX 51st. Thank you, Jody.
All right. Well, thank you, Kim. Thank you, everyone, for this, especially our panelists, awesome panelists, Ms. Kendra Carr and Ms. Carolyn Sadeko. We appreciate you all. I put a copy into the chat and updated that since Kim had put the latest link in there. So you're more than welcome to download that. It has all the links to those PCA Dev Zone links, PDFs, whatnot. And then also to the lovely resources for Kendra and Carolyn. But we greatly appreciate it. I had a great time here. I'm a father of three, so this was a joy to be a part of this. You all take it easy, take care, and we will see you all next time. Have a great weekend.